Thank you very much for the very kind introduction. This title was invented by my cultural counselor, and maybe I should have said to him that it's like Sir Humphrey, that it's very courageous. But let's see whether I can stay under that heading. So thank you very much for this opportunity to speak about cultural diplomacy to a Commonwealth audience. This is a bit paradoxical that someone like me, representing a small, remote, non-Commonwealth nation like Finland, is sort of lecturing about something that Commonwealth probably, in my view, has managed to perform and illustrate very well, perhaps better than many other institutions active in international politics. But here we go. Cultural diplomacy, to me, goes under the general heading soft power, quote unquote. I would say that all cultural diplomacy can be seen as an effort to use soft power. Soft power, in turn, may cover issues which are broader than purely cultural, depending, of course, how do you define culture. There are broad, there are narrow definitions. I have had the pleasure of speaking to young Commonwealth diplomats about soft power on some earlier occasions here in London, and I have really emphasized, as an outsider's conception, that Commonwealth constitutes an important source of soft power. And surely cultural issues, cultural assets, underpin much of what Commonwealth is able to do. Cultural diplomacy, to me, is continuation of politics and traditional diplomacy by other means, to paraphrase the famous maxim of Karl von Clausewitz. And in line with Joseph S. Nye's definition of soft power, this famous American politologue, effective cultural diplomacy requires ability to persuade others through intellectual and artistic accomplishments or values or ideas, as opposed to hard power, which conquers or intimidates through military might or political pressure. Now, cultural diplomacy is always conducted in order to pursue some objectives. Ultimately, nations invest in cultural diplomacy in order to enhance, one way or the other, their national interests. More concretely, this may imply national security interests, commercial interests, including those of one's tourism industry, or more vaguely defined goals regarding the nation's sort of general image or brand in the world. It can be cultural diplomacy practiced by either governments, private sector, or civil society. And the toolkit of cultural diplomacy can contain very diverse instruments, ranging from arts to sports, from science to business, from language to religion, and so forth. The point Mr. Lucas made about football, I think, is very on the spot. It is a very important part of British image around the world. Even me, ambassador of Finland, the third question people usually ask here in London to put to me is about football. First one is, how long have you been in London? Second, do you enjoy it? Third, which football club do you support? Well, I usually say West Ham, because it's the only club where there is a Finnish player at the moment. Substitute goalkeeper. But on the other hand, it's very useful also for Finns and foreigners to go to Upton Park and see West Ham matches for the reasons that Mr. Lucas pointed out, that Britain is not only Westminster and Whitehall. East London should be seen as well. Now, cultural diplomacy, this fine concept, is relatively new. But in practice, it has been with us for centuries. Explorers, travelers, traders, teachers, missionaries, artists, broadcasters, filmmakers, they have all, to some extent, engaged in some sort of cultural diplomacy, and they have played a part as informal ambassadors, quote unquote, for their countries. Hollywood in the US, and let's say Pinewood Studios here in the UK, have been tremendously effective operators of cultural diplomacy in the past. In 1955, the New York Times declared Louis Satchmo Armstrong as, quote, America's most effective ambassador, unquote. I read it somewhere, probably your website. The Beatles for Britain, ABBA for Sweden, Kylie for Australia, or Lang Lang for China have had similar great impacts. And thanks to Yorkshire Television's old series, which were filmed in picturesque Yorkshire villages, and they are still shown regularly in Finland, most Finns have a very positive, if not idealistic, conception of today's Britain. Now, Finnish television had a great impact on neighboring Estonia during the Cold War. The Estonians, linguistically related to Finns, could watch Finnish TV and have a first-hand view of a Western consumer society, cultural diversity, political freedoms, on which our system has been built. So when Soviet Union and communism started to implode 25 years ago, Estonians were among the first to break out and establish a new future and new identity for their nation. Now, Britain's cultural diplomacy was for centuries linked with the advance and blossoming of the British Empire. The Empire certainly was the vehicle for the great impact that English language and British culture had all over the world. When the Empire unraveled in political terms, the British cultural empire was not destroyed. It has persisted, helped, symbolized by the Commonwealth, which is a major achievement indeed. Millions of people come to Britain every year to see, in particular, London, its famous buildings and other landmarks. They have seen these in films and on TV, and they have read about them, but they want to experience them firsthand, personally. Pictures of visitors with Big Ben, red telephone booth or mailbox, or the gates of 10 Downing Street in the background are, for many, the real highlights of their British tour. And when strolling around in London, we often find ourselves walking in the backdrop of a movie, TV series, or an iconic, globally broadcast royal celebration. So any other country can envy the position Britain enjoys in cultural diplomacy. But such a comfortable position may also entail a risk. Even if great places of central London are part of global patrimony, and even if Yorkshire villages and hilly landscapes are so wonderful as they are, we know that this is not the whole truth of Britain and its modern realities. There are, like in all societies, also problems, tensions, and even decay. Now, nobody wants to advertise such aspects, but promoters of cultural diplomacy must keep also such drawbacks in mind in the name of, let's say, realism. If reality and image diverge too much, cultural diplomacy is bound to fail. Now, compared to Britain, Finland's image in the world rests on much narrower shoulders. The vast majority of the world's population have, I'm afraid, no idea of Finland at all. For those who know something, the image is often sketchy and based on sporadic elements, depending on the person's hobbies or walk of life. Finland could be a Formula One pilot like Kimi Räikkönen for someone, or Angry Birds, or Santa Claus, or Jean Sibelius, or in recent years, a Nokia mobile phone for others. If a person knows a Finn, which is rare, then the knowledge and relevance of Finland shoots up immediately and significantly. If a person has visited Finland, even briefly, and many British and foreign Baltic cruise customers do, for example, they usually have a vivid and very positive recollection. They want to go back. And as a general rule, the image of Finland is usually not a source of concern for us who represent Finland abroad. Perceptions and images of countries are known to be very long-standing and very stable. Even occasional bad news do not normally shatter them to any serious degree. Now, what is our concern as agents of public or cultural diplomacy, for example, here in London, is what is our concern? It is the relevance of Finland. Even if the image of Finland in the UK is very positive, what is a British citizen supposed to do? Think about it or care about it? Finland is great, but so what? Maybe a typical gut reaction of an average Brit. And we Finns, we may think likewise, say about Scotland, which, by the way, although being of the same size as Finland, is much, much more well known around the world, thanks to the British Empire, for example, and of course. Scotland is beautiful, culturally rich, charming, but so what? Might be a typical Finnish reaction. So to make Finland and Finnish culture relevant for, say, a British audience, we must not only communicate, exhibit, and inform, but we must also listen, observe, and analyze. What are the big issues in the British society where Finland's achievements could find an echo? Can we perhaps touch people's minds and even influence certain debates here in the UK if we bring the right Finnish actors or experts in contact with British society? Can we offer constructive, practical, and workable examples through collaboration? Now, our assets, seen from the Finnish Embassy in London, normally lie in the issues of children, young people, families, education, let's say gender balance, which was mentioned, harmony with nature, and other aspects of, let's say, good life in a well-organized society. Surely we have a good number of world-class cultural actors, individuals who also act as great ambassadors of Finland. And in this country, they are particularly numerous in the field of classical music. And I hear in London more music of Jean Sibelius than I would hear in Helsinki. But these stars, and sometimes they are mega stars, of Finnish culture, they don't need interventions on the part of our embassy to support their careers. So we try to invest our scarce resources in promoting these other, more societal Finnish assets, which I referred to. So a good cultural diplomat is, above all, in my view, a good listener, sharp observer of the country of his or her posting. You should try to know and understand the country you work in to the best of your abilities. Do not stick only to the capital, again, the same point that Mr. Lucas brought up, and I have tried to follow here my own preaching. I have been more than 150 times outside M25 during my mandate here. Do not stick only to the capital, to its salons and institutions, or to the people who normally or automatically create contacts with foreign embassies. Go to East London, go to see West Ham play. Study the history of the country in question and show that you are genuinely interested in understanding the issues which are being discussed in the media and among ordinary people. This kind of groundwork or footwork helps you approach cultural diplomacy strategically. What is it that you can and wish to influence in the country where you are living? How to nudge the perception of your country in the direction that enhances its position, makes it also better known, and gives optimally even some influence among your host nation's people and decision makers. So in short, our Finnish cultural diplomacy, as far as the embassy is concerned, is very simply defined. Make Finland interesting and, if possible, relevant. Do not expect that your accomplishments can be easily measured, but they may still be significant.